But it's good to be here. And it's just wonderful to see so many young folks here.
Amen.
Yeah, I declare that us older folks have kind of messed up. But praise God, He's given us all another chance.
Amen.
And so I'm going to talk to you a little while today on the mystery of God. The mystery of God. And as I speak to you, I'm speaking to myself. Because I told you last year, since I had my stroke, the Bible has just opened up my mind. Because I took it and sat down after the stroke, told the Lord, now listen, I've been preaching and teaching and reading the Bible for 50 years. And I do not want to miss out on soul salvation.
Amen.
I do not want to miss out on heaven. So as I've been reading the Bible and the things I've read opens up a new whole things that I've been reading it all the time. So I'm going to share with you what I have, and it's already bumped on me, so I'm going to share it with you. Is that all right?
Amen.
So just let us bow our heads. I wish I could get down, but I can't. Father in heaven, we ask that you'd be in our presence today and open unto us what you would have for us to do know. And help us to believe above all things that you can come and live within us. Forgive us for our sins. We ask for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Amen.
Now, in your Bible, turn to Revelation 10. And you've been reading from Revelation all this week. Revelation 10, verse 5 through 7. Revelation 10, 5 through 7. And these are the trumpets, and the trumpets spell out God's trouble on the earth. And verse 10, chapter 10, verse 5 through 7, and it says, and the angel which I saw stand upon the sea and upon the earth lifted up his hand to heaven. Now, it's interesting to me as I've read through the scriptures that somehow John has a very special understanding and a very special love for the Lord. John sees things. John goes through things. John was with Jesus. John stuck up to him. John wrote things down that the other disciples didn't write. And those things are very interesting to me. Now here we have John talking about these trumpets, and he says, verse 6, and swear by him that liveth forever and ever. Who created the heavens and the things that are therein, or in the earth, and the things that are therein, and the sea, and the things which are therein, that there should be time no longer. In other words, the angel is pronouncing an end to all this stuff on this earth. It's going to be over and done forever. And then in verse 7 he says, but in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God shall be finished as he hath declared to his servants the prophets. Now, when you read the prophets have always tried to get through man's mind how God is. And the seventh angel sounds and he stops all the mystery of God. Now, what is a mystery? A mystery, according to the definition in the dictionary, is anything that arouses curiosity. It's anything unexplainable. It's a secret. John says the secret is over, complete, done. Now, interesting enough, Webster, some kind of way, I don't know how in the world he got this definition of mystery. Mystery is a theology, a religious truth revealed through Christ's elect. Now, how in the world he come up with that? A mystery has to do with Christ's elect. It's going to be over. It's going to be done. It's going to be ended. It has to do with Christ's elect. Now, we know the elect are those who have walked and talked with Jesus and are just like Jesus. Now, interesting enough, in Colossians 1, verse 25, you see, Paul had this special understanding that a lot of them didn't have. And John had it, and Paul had it, Jesus gave it. Colossians 1, 25. Whereof I am a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you, to fulfill the word of God. He said, God set me out to be a minister, to give me some information, even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints. This mystery has been hidden and down underneath for ages, but God has called him a minister to bring it out and reveal it. Now notice what this mystery is. And it's still, to me, a mystery.
Mm-hmm.
Now notice what it is. To whom God would make known what is the riches of his glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. The mystery that Paul is talking about and that John revealed is Christ living in us. You don't hardly ever hear it. Nobody hardly ever talks about it. I done been all the way from grade school up to the university and didn't understand what this means in terms of Christ living in you. Now, sad to say, this is the mystery that's going to end. Christ living literally in you. See, now we read about it and it goes over our head. We read about it and we just let it slide off. But you see, what God has tried his best to do, for 6,000 years, he's been dealing with us. He's been working with us. He's been talking to us. He's been trying to do everything he can through the prophets with us. He's been doing all he can with us. And we just don't get it. He says, in order for you all to come up here and be with me in my holy, righteous kingdom, something has to change in you before you get here. Because the way you are, you're not going nowhere. Now, we all know that. No, we strive and we're trying to do this and we're trying to do that and we're trying to do the other. So God in his mercy said, oh, I tell you what. Jesus agreed with him. Said, I'm going to go down there and I'm going to show them how you are, God. I'm going to show them how you are, what you want, and I'm going to help them get themselves like we want them to be. Because they can't be it by themselves. I mean, there's nothing they can do to make themselves righteous and holy and just and good. They can't do that. So I'm going to go down, Jesus says, and I'm going to help them. I'm going to show them how you are, Father. Jesus comes to the earth, born of a virgin Mary, comes into the earth, and he begins to show them. So Jesus goes and he picks out 12 guys. Now, if you know the history of those 12 disciples, you wouldn't pick them guys for nothing. I mean, some of them were crooks, some of them were thieves, some of them was a tax collector that beat folks out of their money. You wouldn't pick nobody like that to follow you and be your disciple.
We would pick one of them.
One of them we'd have picked. Okay. Something one of them we would have picked.
Judas.
Yeah. But the point is, those are not the kind of folk that we would normally have,
no.
You know, to follow us. And so, now looking at us, knowing God like he knows us, he wouldn't probably pick us either. No, he wouldn't probably pick us. There's all kind of attitudes we got.
Yes.
There's all kind of habits we got. There's all kind of problems we got. He wouldn't pick us, but he picked 12. And he said, listen, fellas, what I want you to do is just to follow me and listen at me and watch me, because I want you to be my witnesses. I want you to be a witness for me to let the world know what my Father is all about. Now, I want to just take just that little time here and go to John again, John 6. Now, go to John 6. Now, I'm going to read through this kind of quickly because I got a lot to tell you. Now, John 6. Now, these are his disciples. He's here on the earth. He's trying to show the folk what to do. And he's always constantly trying his best to get more faith in us. See, the problem we got is our faith is weak. Our faith is weak. And our faith won't do what God asks us to do. That's our problem. So all these disciples are following Jesus now. And Jesus here goes up on the mountain and he gets all these folks and he's been healing all the folks in John 6:5. John 6:5. Now when Jesus lifted up his eyes and saw a great company come unto him, he said unto Philip, now Philip is one of his disciples, when shall we buy bread that these may eat? Now, Jesus had just had the witness of John the Baptist as to who he is. He had just worked some miracles and told him that his Father had sent him. He just told him that you're always reading the scriptures and you're trying to find eternal life. Now that word eternal life always sticks out, jumps out at me. So he said, you're reading the Bible and you think by reading the Bible, you know, it'll give you eternal life. And he said, every time you read it, it's talking about me. See, there's some of us just constantly read the Bible. We read the Bible in the morning, read the Bible in the afternoon. We read the Bible and we never understand Jesus Christ. And then he goes down here and there are all these folks to feed. But he asked Philip now, one of his disciples' followers, said, now, Philip, what should we do? Now, Philip had been listening to Jesus. He had seen the miracles, just like, you know, we do. All the things that happen to us all the time, it's a miracle. Jesus provides it. He takes care of us. He watches over us. He feeds us. He gives us health. He gives us strength. All that he provides. Yeah. Yes. See, if we don't overlook it. So Philip overlooking that, Jesus didn't work the miracle. Now he said, okay, what are we going to do? Now notice here, in verse 7, and this Jesus said, verse 6, to prove him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. In other words, Jesus knew what Philip was going to do even after working the miracle. And the point Jesus was trying to get through his head was, man, trust me, believe me, believe what I tell you. So he asked him, said, now, what are we going to do? Now, he had just seen them feed the 5,000. So what are we going to do? And listen, verse 7, Philip answered, 200 penny worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may take a little. He said, now look, if I go out here and work for 2 months, I will not have enough money to feed these folks. Instead of just looking at Jesus, said, listen, Jesus, we got this problem. You know, I believe you can feed them. See, there's something wrong with our mind. See, all that Jesus does to us, he's trying to get us to accept him and let him live in us. It's possible for a disciple or a follower of Jesus not to understand that, just like Philip. Mm-hmm. Now that strikes me. See, now I'm a follower of Jesus. Now I don't have faith like I need to have, just like Philip didn't have faith that he needed to have. So he said, well, let me work. Instead of just going to Jesus and say, listen, Jesus, I know you can take care of these folks. Why don't you go ahead on and take care of them? Wait a minute, let me read on now. Verse 9. There is a lad here. This is Andrew now. Andrew, another disciple, which has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes. What are they among so many? Now, even Andrew, who's a disciple, didn't have no faith in the Son of God.
Yes.
Now, he's 2 of his disciples now. following him, looking at him, watching him, and still don't have faith. Just like us, me. Preaching everywhere, teaching here, going there, reading the Bible. Where's my faith? Hold it now. Verse 10. And Jesus said, make the men sit down. Now that strikes me there, because he said, make the men sit down. I'm sure there was ladies and children in there, but why did he pick out just the men? See? So put them on the ground and bring the fish and loaves to him. And he looked up to heaven and he prayed, and the Lord blessed it. And you know the story. All the folk had were full. They had enough, and they took up 12 baskets after they got done. And then verse 14. Then those men, he singled out the men. I got to find why he did that. When they said the miracle that Jesus did, said, this is one of truth, that the prophet that should come unto the world. They just discovered it. And the thing I'm trying to emphasize is, even though we read the Bible, even though we pray, even though we go to church, we still have a way of missing the point that Jesus wanted. Jesus wants to live in us literally. Hold it now, I'm not through yet. Then Jesus leaves and he goes across the sea, and then they get in a boat and they go across, and then all of a sudden they see him walking on the water. See now, what he's doing with all these miracles is he's trying to get somebody to believe him and trust in him enough to follow him all the way so he can let the Spirit live in them. That's what he's trying his best to do, and we just don't get it. Then he goes down to verse 22. The day following, when the people which stood on the other side of the sea saw that there was none other than a boat, make a long story short, they got in the boat and went across the sea. Now, verse 20. Jesus answered them and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, ye seek me not because ye saw the miracles, but because ye did eat of the loaves and were filled. Why do we follow Jesus? Because we always want something out of him. Lord, give me this. Lord, give me that. Lord, give me something else. Lord, give me that. You ain't following him for what he wants. See, he wants you to put your trust and faith in him. See, that's lacking with us. See what Jesus wants us to do is to pray earnestly that in your head you will choose him rather than your flesh. That's what Jesus and John recorded, the only thing I'm recording, with Nicodemus. See, Nicodemus was a big shot. Oh, he went to church, he paid his tithe and everything, but then he followed, come around at night and followed Jesus. Jesus said, listen, if you're going to have eternal life, something has to happen with you because you can't go like you are.
That's right.
See, we can't go like we are. And see, Jesus was so wonderful with his Father. He said, I'm going to come here and I'm going to guarantee those folks' salvation if I can just get them to believe me. Just believe me. Because I want to live in them. Now that's in my head. Now it ain't never been anything like it before. I want to live in them to guarantee them that they will be with me. So he says, the reason why you followed me is not because of the miracle. You followed me because that bread I gave you, just like us. Well, we want the blessing. We want to pay our tithe because we want the windows of heaven to be opened up for us at all, because we want something physical on this earth. Verse 27, labor not for the meat which perishes, but for that meat which endureth unto everlasting life. See, we work our guts out for something we want on this earth, and we won't lift a mind to tell Jesus, listen, Jesus, come and live in my mind. Come and live in my soul. Come and direct my heart. Come and live in me. Wait, I ain't through yet. Verse 28. Then said, see, now John describes all this because his point is Jesus wants to live in us. Then said they unto him, what shall we do What shall we do? That we might work the works of God. See, just like us, you know. Oh, I'm going to do this here. I'm going to pass out these tracts. I'm going to give these Bible studies. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do the other. And they wanted to do something because God, Jesus, had fed them. So they wanted to do something. Jesus looks up and says, listen, this is the work of God, that ye believe on him who he has sent.
Yes.
If you want to do what God wants you to do, you believe in me. You trust me. You obey me.
Yes. Yes.
Hold it now. Verse 32. Then Jesus said unto them, verily I say unto you. Now, this is really, now here's the core of my message today. Here's the core of my message. Verse 33. For the bread of God is he which cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world. See, the thing that keeps us alive, the thing that motivates us, the thing that gives us strength, the things that gives us life is Jesus Christ.
Yes.
It came down from heaven, and we take it all for granted. Take it for granted. Oh, I'm strong. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do no. Jesus gives you life. Hold it. I'm not through. Verse 36. This is 35 first. And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never what? And he that, believeth on me shall do what? But I say unto you that he also have seen me and do what? Now, how in the world could the people back there then and up here now, back there then, they saw him with their eyes. They heard him with their ears. They could see what he did. And they didn't believe. We today, he blesses us. He keeps us. He protects us. He gives us power to work and do. But we don't believe him. Today, the same thing the disciples and the Jews were guilty of, we are guilty of the same thing. Won't believe. Down in verse 41. Now here's the core of my message. The Jews then murmured at him because he said, I am the bread which come down from heaven. Now the Jews were really just like Seventh-day Adventists. Now I'm just going to put it straight to you. No, really. They're just like Seventh-day Adventists. Murmuring about Jesus, the Son of God.
Mm-hmm.
See, that's the reason why something has to happen within us before we go anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Because God is not going to take us the way we are here, up there, no matter what you do, how many commandments you keep, how many Sabbaths you don't break, or how much church you go to, we ain't going anywhere. There's something has to happen within us.
Yes.
Now here these Jews are who've been talking about Jesus, looking for Jesus, and here Jesus, Son of God, comes and stands in front of them, works all kind of miracles, and they're going to grumble, complain, just like us. But then everybody is, oh, there's a gripe about something. We don't like this. We don't want that. Somebody made me mad. Somebody upset me. Somebody don't believe this. Somebody don't believe that. It's always some type of gripe that we have everywhere. Somebody's wife ain't right. Somebody's husband ain't right. Somebody's pastor ain't right. Something wrong with the conference. Something wrong with the general conference. Something wrong with everything. Murmuring and complaining all the time. Jesus says, I ain't taking that up to my Father's kingdom. And if you want to go there, you're going to go the way I say go. Otherwise, you ain't going. Now, I didn't come out of my Father's house, and I'm coming to the earth. And John says in John 14, we will come and live in you.
Amen.
To guarantee you that you got a change of head. Your mind got to change. Paul understood it. Let this mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Now, wait a minute. I ain't through yet. And the bad part about it was his own brothers didn't believe him.
That's right.
Verse 43. Jesus therefore answered and said unto them, murmur not among yourselves. See, there's always somebody griping, murmuring, complaining, don't like this or that. Then verse 44, no man can come to me except the Father which hath sent me, draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day.
Amen.
See, Jesus, God draws all of us to God, draws us.
Yes.
And even though you die, he says, I'll raise you back up. Mm-hmm. Verse 47, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that, there it is again, believeth on me hath eternal life. Now that's what I want. I want eternal life. I want to live with Jesus. But the way I was, I can't make it. And the way we are, we can't make it. But Jesus says, I'm going to come and live in you. Hold it, let me get on down now. Verse 48, I am the bread of life. Your fathers did not eat manna in the wilderness and are dead. See, they come complaining, didn't Moses give us manna in heaven? See, they're all off again. And Jesus said, no, Moses didn't give you nothing. My fathers put that manna in there. See how we want to give somebody else the credit instead of giving God the credit? That's the way we think. See, we don't think God. We don't think Jesus. See, and he said, that's what I want to live in you for you to do. All right, look, verse 51. I am the what? Living bread, which came down from heaven. And if any man eat of this bread, and he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my what?
Flesh.
Which I will do what? Give for the life of the world. The bread that was in the wilderness represented Jesus.
Amen.
Now they want to give it credit to it was Moses. Verse 52. Now the Jews, therefore, strove among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Now here these Jews, these 70 of us again. How you in the world are you going to give us food, your blood, your flesh, and how you going to do that? Because they don't understand and they don't believe. Whatever God says, he'll do it. And he can do it. And this is the mystery that was hidden for thousands of years that Paul was called to give to the world. Jesus Christ in you, the hope of glory, that the world even today ignores and doesn't believe and don't sanction. When do you ever hear anybody talking about that? Now, interesting enough, God gave this message of Christ abiding in us to Seventh-day Adventists in 1888.
Yeah.
And bless your soul if we didn't turn it down.
Yes.
And that's the reason why when I come along now, nobody gives it to me. They didn't give it to me at the school. They didn't give it to me in college. They didn't give it to me in the seminary. No, where did I get it from? The Word of God.
Amen.
And the Spirit of God in me.
Yes.
And unless you sit and read and study and pray, it'll go right over your head because nobody else does that and tells you that. It's sad. All right, let me go on. Then Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, verse 53, except ye eat of this flesh of the Son of Man and drink this blood, ye have no life in you. Now everybody just goes over that and lets it go away, and that's end of it. Verse 56. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me and I in him. Now I've read that thing I don't know how many times, but it never did dawn on me like it has now. Eating and drinking Jesus Christ. How is it done? What goes on? Now listen, thank God for Mrs. Ellen G. White. Now listen at this. to the death of Christ, we owe even this earthly life. To the death of Christ, we owe even this earthly life. The bread we eat is the purchase of his broken body. See there? Every piece of bread you eat symbolizes the broken body of Jesus Christ. You know, I don't think about that. Well, I just want some bread. What Jesus is trying to tell you is, I want to get inside of your head. I want to get inside of you. Amen. This is why I tell you that. The water we drink is bought by his spilled blood. Now, isn't that something? Now, that's just how earnest Jesus Christ wants to live in us and abide with us. When you eat the bread and drink the blood. And it was the Passover. So he says, I want to live in you. Now listen, never one saint or sinner eats his daily food, but he is nourished by the body and blood of Jesus Christ. So you just eat it and drink and don't, and that's just it. Jesus is trying to live in you. The cross of Christ is stamped on every loaf. Boy. It is reflected in every water spring. All this Christ has taught in appointing the emblems of his great sacrifice. See that right there? That's Jesus trying to live in you. That's him trying to live in you. And you see, the thing about it is, once you do something over and over again, the importance of it leaves. The ordinances that point to our Lord's humiliation and sacrificing suffering are regarded too much as a form. These go through the region, oh yeah, just go through it. They were instituted for a purpose. Our senses need to be quickened to lay hold on the mystery of godliness. See, the mystery of godliness is Jesus Christ trying his best to live in you. Jesus wants you to decide to let him lead and guide and direct you. Now, all of us believe. All of us say we're going to follow Jesus. But we don't have the experience. The experience comes when you decide to follow Jesus and something comes up every day in your life, you let Jesus answer the question.
Amen.
See, I was down here at the dialysis thing yesterday. And I'm sitting up there talking to the lady and my phone rang. One of my young fellas up in Ohio called me way down here. And he didn't know I was down here. And so I don't answer people's questions anymore. If they're sincere, I let them answer. So he said, oh, I got a problem. I said, oh, what you got? I said, man, I'm down here in West Virginia. And he said, I got a problem. I said, I'll tell you what, I'll call you when I get back to my room. So I called him up. He had a problem with his neighbor. I said, tell you what, before I answer your question, I know you're sincere, but the Holy Spirit is trying to work on your mind. I said, just exercise it. I said, now, you got a problem. You told me what it was. Now, just think a minute and tell me what the Holy Spirit is telling you to do. See, Jesus came and stayed 33 and a half years. And most every situation that we find ourselves in, he's handled it. And he said, I'm going to come and live in your head. And so when you run into it yourself, I'll alert you to what you ought to do. And it'll be right in line with my word. Now, the guy said, okay, I tell you, I said, listen, just pause a minute. What is the Spirit telling you to do in your head? He said, you know what? The Spirit is telling me, just let it alone. I said, well, then that's my answer. He said, oh, I feel good about it. See, the spirit tells you stuff, but we ignore it and we yield to the flesh.
Yes.
Now, finally, all true obedience comes from the heart.
Amen.
See, the Jesus wants to work on your brains. Now, heart is mind. Mind and heart are the same thing. It was heart work with Christ. And if we consent, he will so identify himself with our thoughts and aims and so blend our hearts and minds into conformity to his will that when obeying him, we shall be but carrying out our own impulses.
Yes.
Now, isn't that marvelous?
Yes.
When Jesus Christ lives in us, we let him direct our path and our way. His will becomes ours, and we'll be doing his will all the time. The will refined and sanctified and will find its highest delight in doing his service. When we know God, as in our privilege to know him, our life will be a life of continual obedience. You see, what God is trying to do, he's trying his best to get us ready for his kingdom. And he knows good and well the time is going to come when the Spirit of God will be withdrawn from the earth and the only thing you'll have is him living in you. Time of trouble, you can stand. Time of trouble, you can stand. And that's what he's preparing you for. He knows good and well none of us are ready for nothing because we got too much foolishness in our mind. When we know that God is, when we know God as it is our privilege to know him, our life will be a life of continual obedience. And that's what it's more. You see, we've been told that you can't live holy and you can't live without sin on this earth. John says, whosoever is born of God will not sin. When you're born of God, you won't sin because Jesus lives within you. Now, isn't that nice? Now, man, that excites me. I don't know about you. And you just give your heart over to the Lord and say, listen, tell me what to do. And he does. He'll tell you. Got a problem? Say, Lord, what should I do? And he'll tell you what it is. Through an appreciation of the character of Christ, through communion with God, sin will become hateful to us. We'll despise it. We will hate it. And the key point, as Brother Beachy said yesterday, the way that you know that Jesus Christ lives in you is the way that you love people. Your enemies or your friends, it makes no difference. Christ living in you like Jesus was. Whatever you do, wherever you go, he loves everybody. People who hated his guts, he loved them anyhow.
Right.
Jews, Samaritans, whatever it is, love everybody, just like Jesus. And we'll hate sin. And the Bible says that when the angel sounds and the mystery of God is complete, there'll be somebody who will be living a righteous, holy life. And Revelation 14, my last text, Revelation 14. Revelation 14. You see, I can understand now how come it won't be but a handful relative to all the millions of the people in the earth. I can understand it now. I didn't understand it before. Revelation 14, 144,000.
Sing the song of Moses.
That's right, don't read it all. Sung a song of Moses, they sung, as it were, a new song.
Yes.
Before the throne and before the four beasts and the elders. And no man could learn that song but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. those who are redeemed from the earth will be perfect because Jesus Christ will live in them. And these are they which are not defiled with women. In other words, they haven't been contaminated with false doctrine.
Yes. That's
right. False doctrine. Mm-hmm. See, there's false doctrine in all of us. For they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb wherever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and unto the Lamb. The very best, because they had Jesus Christ living in them. They were sacred, they were holy, their thoughts were clean, they despised sin and the devil. Time over, 144,000. And in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. Now there's going to be somebody like that who lets Jesus live in them, and I want to be one of them.
Amen.
Nobody else like that. I want Jesus to live in me, and I want him to live his life out of me. Paul says that the fruits of the Spirit, love, but joy, peace. See, that one word, you know, that's what Jesus said, listen, let not your hearts be troubled. Told his disciples, don't worry. See, people who are sincere are always concerned. Am I going to heaven? I just wonder. You know, I wonder if I'm going to be lost. You just want Jesus, let you know. Don't be worried about that. He says, I'm going to fix it the way, if you just believe me, I'm going to take you in. Because I don't want you to live. He said, we, my Father and me, going to live and come live in you. And it's going to abide with you and dwell with you forever. As a guarantee, you will make it. If you just can believe. See, that's the big problem with us. He says it, and we don't believe it. May God help us and bless us as we partake of his broken body and spilled blood.
Amen.
Jesus wants to live in us. And one way he does, he says, when you eat the bread and drink the blood, you're living in me as a symbol. God bless you.
Amen.